Good morning. Welcome to Shatter Up Church Online. We're excited to worship the Lord this morning, and I want you to join with us and sing to the Lord. God, we love you. We welcome you into this place and to every home right now in the name of Jesus.
I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders.
Yes, I do.
I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. My praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony.
Amen. Hallelujah. Good news. Grace rewrote our story. Sing with us.
Come together, sons and daughters. Bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started.
That's a good promise, sing it.
Our God will finish what He started. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. You're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come.
Let's sing it again. If I'm not dead.
If I'm not dead, you're not done. Oh, no, no. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not. Testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Oh, yeah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. The Bible says he who began a good work in you is faithful to complete it. That means if you're not dead, he's not done, like we said before. And I know many of you are holding on to promises that you've prayed about for a long time, that you're not seeing the fulfillment of that yet. I want to encourage you this morning to keep pressing in and believing that you're going to see a victory, because he is faithful to do what he said he would do and to finish what he started. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never.
see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, it belongs to you, Jesus. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will. Down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I do, Lord. Yes, I know how this story ends. Sing it with us this morning. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the with us. You take the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. I don't know how you do it, Lord, but you do it. Let's sing it again. Oh, yes, you do. Yes, you do. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Oh, yeah. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory.
Good to see you all.
Good to see you guys.
Thank you. I chose you guys today as our congregational check-in just because you're both so, you all are so involved at the church, and if people come to the church, obviously they're going to see Janet. Janet, do you want to explain kind of your role at the church?
I'm the experienced team coordinator, so I get the wonderful opportunity to organize a lot of the volunteers, greeters, doing communion, ushers, all the wonderful people that volunteer at our church. So I'm super blessed because I get to be part of all of the volunteer team, and then I help the different departments if they need extra help, but mostly greeting and that type of thing.
Yeah, a lot of times
everything happens. We love Janet.
She calls all kinds of new people, and so if you get a call from a super friendly person, it's usually Janet. So Janet is amazing. We love her. And then Cass and Dan, you guys want to explain kind of your role at the church as well?
Yeah, so I'm the children's pastor for SRKM. So that's been super fun doing the drive-throughs. So come if you have a kid from first through fifth, or even from birth through fifth. Come to our events, look for our emails. We're always looking for more engagement and connection because I miss the kiddos during the Sunday morning. That's what I do.
Yeah.
I'm kind of a volunteer extraordinaire.
He's voluntold a lot.
Yeah, voluntold more often than not. But so I do a lot of the AV stuff, run slides, run the lighting during worship, volunteer and help out with the youth events. I'm the actually the middle school boys small group coach whenever we actually meet in person and sometimes over Zoom. So that's kind of what I do.
Well, I've been known to go in and grab you to help us too. So
yeah.
He is the volunteer extraordinaire. So, hey, just wanted to ask you guys, what's the funnest thing you've done since this horrible pandemic has begun? What would you say as you think back on the last few months, what's the funnest thing you've done? What would you say you appreciate the most about this time?
Well, you know, they call it quarantine. I call it quality time, team.
Because you're a newlywed. You've been married 2 years. So do you just sit and stare at Dan all day, every day and love it?
I've quit all of my jobs. I just stare at him all day long. It's the best thing I could do. No, but it's been fun. And he's had to leave for work, so we didn't get that stay-at-home experience where couples are like, I love you, but I love when you're at work. So we didn't have to go through that. But yeah, like, we celebrated our 2-year anniversary.
We did.
And
about a month ago.
Yeah, so we went up to Monterey because Trisha and Craig went, and whatever they do must be a good idea. So we followed, and the weather was amazing, and it was hard to come back.
Yes. We loved that trip too. It was awesome. We drove up the coast of California and just loved it. The weather was beautiful, so it was really fun. Janet, what about you? What would you say has been the funnest thing?
Well, I have to say that I love the location you guys chose. That's where we spent our 30th anniversary, and I loved it. I've been able to go up to the mountains where it's cooler to my sister's house. She has a zip line. That's a lot of fun.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, deer and elk, and they have a lot of acreage up there, and it's just so much cooler than the weather here. And then I've gone down to San Diego to see the kids and Lake Havasu. Not when it's busy. I go during the week when nobody's there. So anyway, I've had some getaway out of the house, you know, just to spend time with family and friends.
I've called around to check in on different people at the church. It's been really nice to hear that so many people are taking advantage of this time to connect with family, connect with close friends, get out of the heat, go someplace nice. So that's been a perk, despite everybody knows how hard it's been in so many ways, but there are some bright spots and silver linings that we can focus on too. So, okay, well, just wanted to check in with you guys. Thanks for doing this tonight. You can send your love to Shadow Rock Church.
Oh, we love you guys. We're missing you.
Love you.
Can't wait till we're back in person.
Can't wait to see everyone again.
All right.
Bye.
Hi, everyone.
Well, hey, everybody. My name is Bruce, and I am a volunteer here at Shadow Rock Church. We want to welcome you to Shadow Rock Church Online. So I know I look like either I'm your waiter or that guy you hide from when the doorbell rings, but I came from work here. I apologize for being so formal, but I am just glad to be here today with you on this Sunday, celebrating and worshiping together, even though we are online. Well, we have a lot of ways to get connected here. There's a lot of great stuff happening you may not know about. Number one, we have a ladies' Bible study that has formed on Zoom. So if you would like to get plugged in on the ladies' Bible study, you'd like to know when it is, you want to be part of it, email your information to info@shadowrockchurch.com and we will make sure that you have the link, that you're connected back with us. That is going to be a great thing. Hey, also, we have this amazing thing that's going to be coming up. It is a drive-through celebration. It is a drive-through, boy, adventure, drive-through. See, I wish my son-in-law Aiden was here. He does such a good job explaining this.
Hey, what's up, everybody? My name is Aiden Miller. I'm the youth pastor at Shadow Rock Church. We got some big news for you. Hey, we know that right now it's a discouraging time. It's an aggravating time, and oftentimes it feels like it's a hopeless time. So here's what we're doing. On Friday, September the 4th, we're doing an awesome event at 7 p.m. It's a drive-through scavenger hunt at our new church building. You're not going to want to miss at 7 p.m., okay? It's a five-mile radius. It's going to be a huge scavenger hunt for the whole entire city. You're not going to want to miss. Get all your soccer friends there. We're going to be in each of us are going to have different types of cars, or all your cars that you bring. Each car is going to have a list of things to find all across our city, okay? So it's going to be fun. The winner gets this, a flat-screen TV. Don't tell Pastor Craig, that was a little too much money, okay? Keep it on the DL. So listen, you're not going to want to miss. It's going to be a great event, September the 4th, Friday at 7 p.m. The best scavenger hunt you have ever seen in your entire life is going to take place. You don't want to miss. You don't want to miss your friends. You don't want to miss this awesome event. So we'll see you then at 7 p.m. on Friday the 4th. God bless you. We'll see you there.
If only Aiden was here. But, well, anyway, hopefully I'll have more information about that. That's coming up next month. As always, there are three ways to give here at Shadow Rock. You can mail in your check, you can give online, or you can even text to give, as the graphic is saying. Thank you, one and all, for your faithfulness. We are so appreciative of that. And you're not just giving to Shadow Rock Church, but you're giving through Shadow Rock Church to make all these great things happening. If we can help you in any way during this time, please email us at info@shadowrockchurch.com, and we'd love to connect with you. Put your name, contact information, and ways that we can help you. And last but not least, be sure to comment in the comment section or in the chat section. Send us an emoji. Let us know that you're watching. And let us know, what's your favorite part of the service? Do you like the check-in? Do you like the sermon? That's my favorite part. Whatever it is, be sure to let us know. Otherwise, we'll have a great day here, and we'll see you next week here at Shadow Rock Church Online.
Hello and welcome, everybody, to Shadow Rock Church Online. My name is Craig Cunningham, and I'm the lead pastor. And we are so excited that you are here. Shadow Rock is a place where real people find authentic faith, and we're praying that you have an amazing time with us. We are in a conversation that we're going to continue today, but it's called How to Find a Good God in Bad Times. And we've really tapped into Paul's letter to the church at Thessalonica and really looked at how there's a good God in the midst of all of the circumstances that we're facing, even right now. First week, we talked about how we are chosen to be people of faith, love, and hope. And when everything else kind of goes astray, those are the things that remain: faith, love, and hope. The next week in this conversation, we talked about how in bad times, we are people who have good news, and we want to connect with that good news and make that good news available to as many people as we possibly can. And the good news is this: that God in Jesus Christ is not counting men's sins against them, that he is extending to us an offer of forgiveness and an invitation of relationship, and we hope that you are able to connect with him and that you can make him available to other people, and that this good news is something that is close to your heart, and you're just looking for every opportunity you can to connect with people who are going through bad times. Last week, we talked about how we find a lot of hope and comfort in the fact that we are people of purpose, we are people of love, and we are people of identity. You know, those are the core needs that all of us have in bad times, when we're really shaken to our core, we're not sure kind of what we believe. Sometimes the circumstances just kind of lead us astray. And those are the things that really anchor us, that we have a purpose in bad times, that we have love, that we are loved and have the ability to love others in the midst of bad times. And we have identity in the midst of bad times, that we know who we are in Christ. And that's so important. So this week, we're going to be looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And I want to start out by saying this. Isn't it interesting that people are fascinated with connecting with the dead? Even right now, people want to somehow feel like their life has some eternality, that their life has meant something if they have a parent or a spouse or a son or a daughter who has passed away. There really is this intense desire to know that they're okay, this intense desire to maybe even try to communicate with them. In fact, in July 17th, 1913, Harry Houdini's mom died after suffering a stroke, and he was so stricken with grief that many historians say that he tried to attend seances in the hopes of communicating with her. But unfortunately, he was so well trained as a magician himself that he would spot a fraud from a mile away, and he spotted fraud after fraud after fraud. And he was so disillusioned by his encounters with these spiritualists that claimed that they could talk with the dead that he started to attend the seances in disguise. And when he spot the trickery and he could figure out what was going on and how they were trying to fool different people, he would stand to his feet and declare, "I am Harry Houdini, and you are a fraud." He eventually started an awkward friendship with another famous person at the time, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, of course, was the author of his very famous series based on his character, Sherlock Holmes. And while Sherlock Holmes was famous for his logic and his deductive abilities, Doyle himself was fascinated by spiritualism and connecting with the dead and seances and Ouija boards and the occult and all of those different things. And at the time, Doyle really wasn't alone, because in the wake of World War I, death had touched thousands of different households. And friends and relatives of fallen soldiers had flocked to seances, desperate to receive some word or sign that there was some kind of life beyond death, some kind of life beyond the veil. One of the most famous of these spiritualists was a 36-year-old who called herself Marjorie the Medium. Her real name was Mina Crandon. And Mina's charisma and personal charm had really propelled her to international fame. And her fame brought her to the attention of a well-known magazine at the time called Scientific American. And Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's endorsement of Mina as someone who was a legitimate spiritualist and a legitimate medium, it had inadvertently placed her in the center of a growing controversy, because people were wondering, was this really true? Could this be valid? Could it be trusted? And so in December 1922, the magazine launched an investigation into the paranormal with a cash prize of $2,500 to the first person who produced proof of their psychic abilities to the satisfaction of their committee of investigators. And the investigating committee would be comprised of four or five different people. And one of those, surprisingly, was Harry Houdini. And they asked him to lend his talents to this committee to see if there was any legitimacy to any of these mediums. As it happened, Houdini wasn't notified by the magazine committee that they had begun their investigations into Marjorie the Medium. And he didn't learn until months later that the proceedings were already underway. And rumor had it that all of the committee, with the exception of Harry Houdini, had decided that they were going to award the prize to Marjorie the Medium, considering her completely legitimate, having attended several of her different seances. But when Houdini joined the seances, he could immediately spot the ruse. At one seance, Mina used her foot to ring this mysterious bell that she said was actually rung by her dead brother. At another seance in the darkness, she put a megaphone on her head, and it was before they joined hands. So they turn off the lights. It could be completely and totally dark. She'd put this megaphone on her head, and then everybody would hold hands while she balanced the megaphone upon her head. And at some point in the seance, she would quickly jerk her head forward, causing this megaphone to fall forward, and everybody would gasp in astonishment that somebody, some spirit had done this. Even Houdini acknowledged that this trick was what he called the slickest ruse he had ever seen, but he knew how she was doing it. Houdini eventually designed even a special fraud preventer cabinet with openings only for Mina's head and for her arms. Once inside, her movements and opportunities for deception would be severely limited. And of course, once she was in that box, that night the seance was not successful. Long story short, the American Scientific American magazine never had to award its $2,500 cash prize, mainly because of the investigation of Harry Houdini, who was able to defunct this person who was defrauding really crowds of multitudes of people. You know, it's interesting, even 100 years later now, we're still interested in trying to communicate with the dead. In fact, there are mediums that are very, very popular today. Just a decade ago, you may remember the show Crossing Over with John Edward. John Edward would do kind of readings with different people, and he would charge even as much as $800 for different large events that he would have with crowds and crowds of people that would all come and pay exorbitant amounts of money just to have them read them. But what he was doing is kind of cold reading, when you really didn't know anything about the person, but you would kind of base different things on different reactions that they would have. But there was also accusations that he was hot reading people, which means that he actually knew in advance some information about the different people. In fact, at his show, Time Magazine did an expose of this where the audience would come in, and for 8 hours they'd be sitting there to tape for, you know, a 30-minute show. And during those 8 hours, there's hot mics everywhere, and their producers writing down different things as people are coming in. Of course, they're talking about their dead relative. They're hoping that John Edward would do some kind of reading, and so they're able to pick up that information. There's even accusations that there are actors in the audience who would listen to different conversations and convey that to John Edward. And much of the information, I watched several of the shows, much of the information is such broad generalities, and the number of times that they're wrong is staggering. Even more recently, there's a medium called the Hollywood Medium. You may have seen this show with Tyler Henry. Even into our valley, driving into our valley, there was a big event as Tyler Henry was going to come, and people would, again, pay exorbitant amount of money to see Tyler Henry read different people and try to cross over to have this conversation with the dead. In fact, he's had interviews with on the Today Show with Matt Lauer, with Hoda Kotb, with Jenna Bush Hager, and they're there, and they're just crying about some of the things that he's saying. He's had interviews with celebrities like Kim Kardashian, people who are on the show The View, and it's amazing how people just buy into this. Interestingly enough, there's a $1 million paranormal challenge that was offered by a magician by the name of James Randi. His educational foundation offered to pay $1 million for any proof of supernatural paranormal ability under scientific testing criteria. And so he developed this $1 million challenge. It started in 1964 when he was on a radio show, and some psychic said, well, why don't you put your money where your mouth is? And so he did, $1 million. And in 1964, he extended that challenge. And for decade after decade after decade, that was out there. And about 1,000 different people applied to take that challenge, but none of them was successful. It was only about 5 years ago that they finally terminated the challenge as the foundation was getting a lot older. They adjusted some of their different different methodologies. But it's interesting, people are desperate to know that there's some life after death, that the people that have passed on are okay. They're desperate to communicate to them. And in fact, they'll buy into, you know, people who are granted very talented at reading different reactions and very talented in terms of their intuition, but aren't connecting with the dead at all. There's no assurance there at all. And it's interesting, the Bible talks about this. The Bible talks about lifting the veil of death and being able to see on the other side, and that we could have assurance of what our eternity might actually look like. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13, Paul said it this way. He said, "And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so that you will not grieve like people who have no hope." You know, as a pastor, I'm around kind of big events in people's lives. I'm there as children are born. I'm there as people are getting married, so situations of life, situations of love. And I'm also there, at baptisms, so situations of faith. But I'm also there when people pass away. And it's interesting, there are people who have such hope. They know that their loved one is in heaven, and there are also situations of people who have no hope. And they're desperate to kind of have an idea of what happens when you die, and they're very open to questions about their own mortality and what Jesus offers them. But he says, we don't grieve as those who have no hope. We have hope. And it's interesting, there's a Greek word that he used when he talks about to know what will happen to the believers who have died. The word he uses there is a word that other translation says, we don't want you to be ignorant about these things. So that word ignorant means, it's the root word of where we get the word agnosticism, where people just don't know. And there's so many people out there that just simply don't know. They don't have hope. They're questioning. I think it opens the door to even spiritualists and mediums and the paranormal even today, because people have such intense questions. Paul goes on to say, for since we believe that Jesus died and he himself was raised to life again, well, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. So there's this assurance of faith that is hinging upon the credibility of Jesus and the credibility of Jesus indeed rising again. Jesus himself talked about his return in Mark chapter 13. There's different gospels. There's Matthew and Mark and Luke and John, these four evangelists, some people call them. They're telling the stories of their own personal accounts of Jesus. And Mark is recording these words of Jesus as he's talking about his return. And he says it this way. He says, then everyone, and Jesus is talking about himself, he says, then everyone will see the Son of Man. That's a term that he used for himself. The Son of Man coming on the clouds with great power and glory. And he will send out his angels to gather his chosen ones from all over the world, from the farthest ends of the earth and heaven. And he says, however, no one knows the day or the hour when these things will happen, not even the angels in heaven or the Son himself. So it's interesting when you see somehow famously different people make predictions. Well, I know the date that Jesus is going to come, and they set different dates, and then that date transpires, and they're like, well, I got it wrong. Maybe it's this date. But no one knows. But Jesus will come again. He himself said so. He says, only the Father knows. And since you don't know when that time will come, be on your guard. Be ready. Stay alert. The writer of Hebrews in chapter 9 says it this way. He says, and just as each person is destined to die once, and after that comes judgment, so also Christ was offered once for all time as a sacrifice to take away the sins of many people. And he will come again. He will come again, not to deal with our sins, but to bring salvation to those who are eagerly waiting for him. And that's why throughout history, followers of Jesus have said, come, Lord Jesus, come. Because we recognize we live in a very broken world. You know, there are people who live in oppression, who live in slavery, who live in starvation, who live in absolute deprivation in terms of their life. This world is broken, but Jesus is coming to rescue us. It's interesting that even in the different chapters we've looked at through this conversation, this idea of Jesus' return is a common theme that comes up over and over and over again. And we learn that Jesus' return is our ultimate salvation. He said it this way in 1 Thessalonians 1, and now the word of the Lord is ringing out from you to people everywhere, even beyond Macedonia and Achaia. For wherever we go, we find people telling us about your faith. And so the faith of the Thessalonians had become famous. He goes on to say, we don't need to tell them about it, for they keep talking about this wonderful welcome you gave us and how you turned away from idols to serve the living and true God. And then he said this. He says, they speak about how you're looking forward to the coming of God's Son from heaven, Jesus. So there's this expectation. Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. He's going to rescue us. And this is a group of people who had suffered intense persecution, the loss of life, the loss of businesses, the loss of sons and daughters, the loss of finances. He said, he is the one who has rescued us from the terrors of this coming judgment. So salvation, it means rescue. And there's a past reality to that. Jesus has rescued us from our past and all of our shame and all of our sin. He's wiped that away through his death and sacrifice upon a cross. That price has been paid. He's rescuing us in our present reality. He's making us more and more like him. But he's also ultimately rescuing us and preparing a place in heaven for each and every single one of us. And so that ultimate reward of our salvation as Jesus is returning triumphantly, victoriously, to take us all to be with him in heaven. We get there by either dying in this world, our physical bodies just age, or we get sick, or we get in an accident and we die, or Jesus is coming again, and there's an end to the power of this world, where Jesus is coming once again to take all those that are followers of him to be with them in heaven. Jesus' return is also our reward for service. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 19, it says, after all, what gives us hope and joy, and what will be our proud reward and crown as we stand before the Lord Jesus when he returns? It is you. Yes, you are our pride and joy. And it's rather fascinating that Paul is talking about his investment and his service and all the different sacrifices that he made. He understood that when Jesus is coming, he will be rewarded for this act of service. And not only will we be rewarded, but we'll be held to account for the things that we've done. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, another letter that's written by Paul to the church at Corinth, says it this way, for we live by believing and not by seeing. Yes, we are fully confident, and we would rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we would be at home with the Lord. And let me just stop there. Another translation would say it this way, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And sometimes the Bible says, well, that person has fallen asleep, and they really mean that person has passed away, that they've died. And so there is some ideas in theology that people are buried into the ground, and they're just sleeping, and they're waiting for Jesus to come. But clearly, that's contradicted right here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. In fact, when Jesus comes, he's coming with those that have passed away before. They're already with him. And it goes on to say this, so whether we are here in this body or away from the body, our goal is to please him. For we must all stand before Christ to be judged, every single one of us. We will each receive whatever we deserve for the good or evil we have done in this earthly body. And so Jesus' return is a reward for our service, but it's also an accountability to the things that we've done. Did we respond to him? Did we ignore him? Did we live for our own selfishness and our own pride? Or did we decide to acknowledge him and surrender our life to him and believe in him? And so Jesus' return is the ultimate reward for our salvation. It's the ultimate reward for our service. It's also the anchor of our strength. We just looked at this chapter last week, but it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 11, it says, may he, as a result, make your hearts strong and blameless and holy as you stand before God, our Father, when the Lord Jesus comes again with all his holy people. And so there was this expectation, Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. And because he's coming, we can endure the hardship that we're going through. We can endure sickness and disease and persecution. We can endure the loss of finances. We can endure some of the things that we have to struggle through. We can endure pandemics. We can endure a fragmented country. We can endure all of this because we know at the end of the day, Jesus is coming and he's going to make right everything that was wrong. And it's the source of our strength to weather through some of these different storms. And so Jesus' return is our ultimate salvation. It's our reward for service. It's the anchor of our strength. But it's also the comfort in sorrow. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13 says, and now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died so that you will not grieve as those who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring with him the believers who have died. And so there's this comfort for those that have lost a loved one, whose son died tragically in an automobile accident, whose daughter tragically got sick and died, whose grandfather has passed away. All of these people, you know, I just talked to some friends of mine, they're mother died of COVID-19 recently, and the grandmother has COVID-19. There's a comfort in our sorrow, in our grief, knowing Jesus is coming back, and he's coming back with all those that have called upon his name. The question is this, are you ready for Jesus' return? You know, sometimes we think that we have all the time in the world to get our affairs in order. As you know, I received a diagnosis last year of stage 4 colon cancer. And I wasn't given much of a chance. And many of the doctors made a suggestion to me, you should get your affairs in order. And what they meant by that is, you know, you should have a will and you should have some kind of estate plan financially, get all your affairs in order so you know that your kids are taken care of and that your wife is taken care of. But spiritually, because we don't know when Jesus is going to return. We don't know if we'll die in an accident. We don't know if we'll get sick or be diagnosed with something or maybe suddenly we're just, you know, our bodies fail us and we die. We should be ready. We should get our affairs in order. And it's so important that you search your heart and you examine your life and you are alert and you're ready because Jesus himself says, I'm going to come. And it's going to be like any other day. No one will see it coming, but it'll be like a thief in the night. Two people are standing next to one another, and one is just caught up. We may not have that opportunity to get our affairs in order, to be ready. And my prayer is that you're ready to meet Jesus when he comes.
I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the Father as he says, son, go get my children. And at the midnight cry, we'll be going home. I look around me, I see prophecies fulfilled every day, signs of the times they're appearing everywhere. I can almost see the Father as he says, son, go get my children. And at the midnight cry, the bride of Christ will rise. When Jesus steps out, around me, I see prophecies fulfilled every day, signs of the times they're appearing the midnight cry. At the midnight cry, we'll be going home. You know we'll be going, we'll be going home.
So I want to ask you that question again. Are you ready? Maybe you need to get your affairs in order, because at some point you're either going to die or Jesus is going to come back and you're going to see him face to face, and you'll be held accountable for the way that you live your life, and he's provided a way for you to be saved. Are you in right relationship with God by putting your faith in Jesus? You know, all of us are apart from God because of our sinfulness and our brokenness. We've all fallen short of being the people that he's called us to be. And there's a huge chasm of sin, but Jesus, when he died on a cross and stretched his arms across this torture device, he bridged the gap. And through him, you can be saved. So if you want to get your affairs in order, I'd love to have the opportunity to pray with you. It just means simply that I'm going to admit that I'm a sinner, that I've fallen short. I'm going to admit the truth that I need a Savior, that I'm going to believe that Jesus died on a cross, was buried, and then he rose again. And because he's alive, I too can have life. And I'm going to confess that Jesus is my Lord, that people can see the lordship of Jesus in my life. So pray with me if you would. God, I thank you so much for each and every person that's listening to this message. It's a message that followers of Christ have been conveying for 2,000 years. That God, in his amazing love through Jesus Christ, is not counting men's sins against them. That God, you've made a way for us to be saved. And Jesus, I thank you for dying on a cross for me. I recognize I've fallen short, that I've sinned, that I've not done the good that I know that I should have done. And instead, I've done the bad that I knew I should not have done. And so, God, I need a Savior. And I thank you, Jesus, that you are my Savior, that you died on a cross, that you were buried, and that you rose again, all because of your amazing love for me. And I put my faith in you. You are my Savior. You were exactly who you declared yourself to be, and you accentuated that and verified that by rising from the dead. And I believe in you. And I confess in my heart, Lord, that I'm going to serve you and follow you. And I invite your Holy Spirit into my heart and life to change and transform me, to help me to be who you've called me to be. And I know I'm not going to be there tomorrow, but I'm going to pursue you with all of my heart, soul, mind, and strength. And I'm going to try to share you with as many people as I possibly can. And so, Lord, thank you that now I'm forever changed. Thank you that now I am a new person in Christ, and that the old things are gone and new things have come. I put my trust, I put my faith in you, Jesus. And as the Bible says, I believe that faith is credited to me as righteousness. So thank you with clothing me with righteousness. We pray all this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So the Bible says if you prayed that prayer, you're a new person in Christ. And I'm just so excited to welcome you into this family of God, as all of us who are followers of Jesus are just trying to serve him in every way that we can. And we look with eager anticipation for the time when Jesus will return and we'll see him face to face. And are you ready? If you prayed that prayer, then yes, you are. God bless you. We'll see you next week at Shadow Rock Church.
Hey, thank you so much for watching that service. We premiere our services every single Sunday at 9:30 a.m. Feel free to check us out on our website, shadowrockchurch.com, or our Facebook or YouTube page. We hope to see you next week, and we're going to extend the time of this service so that you guys can continue the conversation in the live chat and the comment section. So God bless you, and we hope to see you again soon.